Hello, everyone. My name is Jason Baxendale. I'm the Assistant Vice President for Plan Giving here at Georgetown University. I want to welcome you to our Estate Planning Essentials for the Hoya family. A couple of things to keep in mind for housekeeping matters. You can submit questions for the webinar on the GoToWebinar panel. And after the webinar, we will submit a survey, which we encourage you to respond to. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Neil Kawashima.
Thank you, Jason. We're very excited to be here today with you. My name is Neil Kawashima. I'm a partner in the private client group based out of Chicago at the firm McDermott Will and Emery. Our group specializes in representation of high net worth individuals and families. We assist them on their estate planning, wealth transfer planning, philanthropy, succession planning, and trust and estate administration. We're delighted to be with you today, and my partners, Elizabeth Glasgow, Tori Ose, and Arianne Plasencia will be doing the heavy lifting today. I just have the honor of introducing them. We're going to have a high-level overview today of the estate tax and estate planning that is applicable to you and your family. Now, this doesn't replace your consultation with your own lawyers. You should do that. But this gives you a bit of a perimeter of things to think about before you consult with her. Elizabeth is going to start by talking about the do's and don'ts of estate planning, what you should be thinking about, and some of the basic terminology surrounding estate planning. Arianne will give you a primer on the transfer tax system, sometimes known as death taxes. That includes the estate tax, the gift tax, and the generation skipping transfer tax. Finally, Tori Ose will give you some specific examples of philanthropic planning that might be useful to you. These are very interesting devices that can be used to benefit not only the charities you care about, Georgetown, for example, but also benefit your family. I'm going to turn it over to my partners now, starting with Elizabeth. Thank you again for having us. It's an honor to be with you today.
Thank you, Neil. I'm going to have to advance my screen. There we go. Sorry. So when we started thinking about essentials for the Hoya family, when we talked about estate planning, one of the first things that we wanted to do was to debunk two myths that we hear a lot in discussions around estate planning with people who have come to this for the first time and are really thinking, how do I protect my family, my friends, and the charities that I want to support? So two myths that have been sort of consistent that we hear from time to time is the idea that if you don't put a customized set of estate planning documents in place before you pass away, that the government is actually going to get all of your property. It's a fear that a lot of people express when they come to us because it's something that they've heard. And the second myth is that if you do choose to do estate planning documents, that the really only function that they have is to leave assets to different people. So those are the two myths that as we kind of go through some of the essentials of estate planning, we're going to talk about why those really aren't true. So one of the first things when people ask, do I need an estate plan? That I always tell them is, you actually already have one. Everyone who lives in the United States has an estate plan already in place. And it's because the government has wanted to make sure that there is some disposition of property when someone dies. This is called intestate laws, and every state in the District of Columbia have them. And they are the default rules that will apply when someone passes away without having given any express or customized instructions for themselves. And naturally, who inherits under these intestate laws are the individuals that you might not be surprised to hear are generally the first in line. So we look to an order of priority, and it's a little hard to describe because this is a national presentation, so we didn't want to do a survey of all 50 states in the District of Columbia. But in general, when you consider looking at a family tree, the first person to inherit is generally the surviving spouse, as well as the person's descendants, which would be their closest individual line, children, grandchildren, maybe even getting more remote to great-grandchildren. And very naturally, these are the first people to inherit because they're the closest family members to someone who's passed away. If those types of people don't exist for an individual, intestate laws will basically branch out into the family, looking for other close individuals. And this will generally be naturally next parents, siblings, nieces, and nephews. And then if even that group doesn't exist, you get into even the farther branches of the family tree, grandparents, you know, aunts, uncles, and cousins. Some intestate laws do provide that if truly the family tree is empty, that they are unable to find anyone who has some kind of connection to the person who's passed away, it is possible in those very unlikely circumstances that the party to inherit actually would be the state government. But this is extremely rare. Generally, the family tree, you shake enough branches, you do find somebody who would inherit. So that is one of the first things to remember, is that everyone actually already does have an estate plan, but it's something that's been set up for us by the government in pretty broad strokes for them to try to determine what would be best for someone who's passing away without having given their own interpretation and instructions. Sometimes we see a circumstance in intestate laws where close family members may end up sharing an inheritance. This is most common when the closest family members are both a surviving spouse as well as children or grandchildren. And in some intestate jurisdictions, they've decided that it's appropriate, rather than one or the other to inherit entirely, that this would be shared. But you're probably seeing right away that there's a lot of things that these intestate laws don't do. So they don't provide, obviously, any kind of specific instructions as to who you favor out of this group of people. So you might feel you'd like everything to go to your spouse and not have things go to your children when you pass away. You may have siblings who you're very close to one and not another, and you would prefer them not to inherit equally from you. And of course, charities are not anywhere included in this group. The other very important factor that a lot of people find missing if they're just looking to intestate laws as the basis of their estate plan is that it really doesn't say what should happen with the inheritance that someone receives. You've worked very hard to collect these assets and earn them over time. And so feeling like you want to know that this has become a legacy that could support, for example, educational expenses for someone, or really making sure that they have retirement support later in life. There's no way to, through intestate laws, give those kinds of instructions as to how you'd like the assets to be used. So you have an estate plan, even if you don't think you do, but perhaps it's not really the right fit for you because, like most of us, we don't think just what the government has given us as a default is necessarily right for everyone. So what does a customized estate plan typically entail? So it usually involves a collection of about five documents. The first two that we're going to review are the will and the revocable trust. And then the next three, the financial power of attorney, healthcare power of attorney, and what are often called a living will or advanced healthcare directive, we're going to turn to those when we debunk the second myth. But so a will and revocable trust, these are really the cornerstone of a customized estate plan. And what is it that they include? So of course, the first thing that they're looking to do is to reflect your preferences as to who will inherit when you pass away. So you can mix and match from that intestacy list. You can pick, of course, people who are not on that list at all. And we often see that times when people who've had close friends who feel like family, who've been important parts of someone's life, but are not technically part of the family tree. We see that often included in people's customized estate planning documents. And charity, again, one thing that was not included in that intestate list and is absolutely can have a place if you're choosing to customize your plan. And again, as well, the opportunity to give more specific instructions as to how you'd like these assets to be dealt with after you're gone, even though you've identified who would receive them. You can also put both guidance as to how they use these assets or even specific mandates that it must be used for specific purposes. The will and revocable trust are also a place where you would identify who it is who is going to be managing your affairs after you're gone. Passing away, of course, involves a lot of paperwork, and you really want to make sure that you have the opportunity in these customized documents to identify someone who will be responsible for handling all of that kind of administrative work. Very important for people who have young children. This is an opportunity in the will to identify who should be guardians of your children, to basically parent them in your absence. And that is a critical component of what an estate plan does. And then last, which we'll be talking about a little bit later, to the extent it's appropriate for you to build in tax planning, that is something that intestate laws do not provide for, but that you can do so in a customized will or revocable trust. Now, right off the bat, a lot of people are saying, you're using two words here, will, revocable trust. What's the difference between them? What do they really mean? So because again, this is a national presentation, it's a little bit different in every state as to which types of documents you may have to do this heavy lifting in your estate plan. Most of us are familiar with the terminology of a will. You know, we've all grown up watching television and movies in which someone's cut out of the will or they're added back in, and it's what drives a lot of the drama. And for many places, a will is the primary document in your estate plan that does all of the things that we've just been describing. And if you choose to have a will as the primary document in your estate plan, it means that at your passing, when it is time to go and determine how this will now be implemented, you know, reading those instructions and getting the assets to the people you've identified with whatever limitations you've decided to place on those assets, that process involves going to a probate court, a local court in your different jurisdictions, to actually go through and facilitate the transfer of these assets. In many states, that process called probate is a fairly seamless process. It's not necessarily a tremendous amount of work. The systems are very smooth, and they're very used to, of course, having people pass away and going through the court system. So if you have a will, you are setting up the process called probate as the method through which assets will pass on to the designated individuals and charities that you've identified. A revocable trust is used in many different states, and it basically takes a lot of the activities that occur in a will, the identification of the beneficiaries, who's going to receive what and how, and it basically places it in another document called a revocable trust that gives you the option for any assets that are held inside that revocable trust during your lifetime to basically avoid that court process called probate. And the reason that this has become common in some states, and in California where I practice, it really is one of the more frequently used structures, is because in not every state is the court system and that probate process so seamless and so quick. So if you're in a jurisdiction, and if in consulting with your attorney, you determine that you're in a state where perhaps the probate process may be a bit lengthy, you might consider a revocable trust. It does many of the same things that the will does, but allows you to circumvent going through the court procedure for any of the assets that have been held inside the revocable trust during prior to your passing. So for all intents and purposes, though, when we think about customizing a plan, you have the option to do these kinds of customizations in either one of those documents. Now, the second myth that we talked about was the idea that giving your assets away is the only thing that an estate plan does. And that's not the case at all. And in fact, I would argue these next documents that I'm going to talk about are even more important. And these are a section of documents that are actually applicable during your lifetime rather than at your death. And they really set up the safety net for you as an adult to make sure someone has legal authority ought to act on your behalf in the event that you are not available to act for whatever reason. And we see this today, accidents, injuries, declining health in your later years. There's a lot of circumstances where you may not be eligible anymore to act as rationally as you should be when making very important decisions for your own benefit. So the first document that applies during your lifetime is called a financial power of attorney. And this is a document where you can identify other people. This is often trusted family, friends, who can come in and really act on your behalf for any kind of financial matters. So they can pay your bills, file your tax returns for you, call Social Security if there's a problem with getting a Social Security check, and they can manage all of your property. Generally, anything that you can do for yourself, they are authorized to do on your behalf. Now, that is only because you in this document have decided to give them that authority. You don't feel comfortable asking someone to have all of these sweeping powers. There's absolutely no reason that you have to give all of them. You can be more limited in your choices. But particularly when we're thinking about a circumstance where you may later on be in a position where you really need someone to do everything for you, we encourage before you get into that sort of limited capacity circumstance that you have considered giving a fairly broad set of powers to someone who can help you when you're no longer able to help yourself. Now, these are actually powers you can give them immediately if for some reason, even though you're fully competent, you would want someone to help you out and do all of these things on your behalf. But typically we see these not becoming effective until you've actually experienced that event. Again, whether it's an accident or illness or just a decline in your mental competency before they would have the authority to act on your behalf. Now, of course, financial decision making is an incredibly important element of your life. But so is healthcare. And if there's a circumstance in which you are not able to make healthcare decisions or communicate them on your own behalf, making sure that you have agents in place through a document called a healthcare power of attorney, this gives you the opportunity to make sure someone can be an advocate for you and communicate what medical decisions should be made on your behalf when you're no longer able to communicate. Again, technically, this can be done at any time. It doesn't have to be just because you're unable to communicate, although it's very rare that we see people who say, I'd like someone else to make all my healthcare decisions, even though I'm fully able and competent to do so. Again, we typically see this occurring, not being triggered and giving that healthcare agent you've appointed the ability to do so until you've become incapacitated. Now, medical decisions mean many things. They can consent to medical treatment on your behalf or refuse it. They can often select healthcare providers for you. And they can give pretty important end-of-life decisions that regard things like the removal of a ventilator or the removal of artificial nutrition and hydration. Now, these are incredibly sensitive topics, and they're not something that you would generally want someone handling on your behalf without having had conversations about it. But it's a very difficult conversation to have, particularly in the end of life circumstance. And so an additional document that we often see in a customized estate plan is something called a living will or advanced healthcare directive. Mean the same thing, but they're just two terms that are used in various different states. And this is where you really have a chance to have written out, if I were in an end of life situation, you know, if I had a vegetative state circumstance, if I'm terminally ill and my prognosis is obviously not good, what are some of the things that I would want to occur or not want to occur? And how can I really help take some of the burden off of my agent to express to them these really were my wishes so that they're not making a decision of their own decision of what's best for you, but they are really actually just implementing decisions that you have already made, but they're now in the opportunity to express them and make sure with the specific facts at hand that your wishes are being fully complied with. So this is sort of the realm of sort of what a customized estate plan looks like. And again, with this very important second set of documents that are lifetime documents, as opposed to just what a lot of people think of as, oh, an estate plan is really just about me distributing my assets when I pass away. You know, I would argue that for many people, these are the things that will affect your quality of life and the ability in your lifetime to continue to have your wishes reflected and honored. And so these are really just as important part as that will and revocable trust, where you have a chance to customize who is inheriting your assets and how. But again, as we talked about, one of the customizations as well in those documents is also the opportunity to do some tax planning. So I'm going to turn it over to my partner to discuss some tax considerations.
Thank you, Elizabeth. So I'm going to be talking about the types of transfer taxes, or sometimes referred to as death taxes. At a federal level, there's really three types of transfer taxes. There's the estate tax, which applies to transfers by reason of death. There's the gift tax, that applies to transfers during lifetime. And there's the generation skipping transfer tax. Now, the gift tax and the estate tax are fairly intuitive, but the generation skipping transfer tax, or GST tax, is a bit more nuanced. The attempt here was for the government to tax transfers to more than one generation below. So the classic example is, let's say a grandparent wants to make a transfer to her grandchild rather than her child. If things had gone in the normal course and the grandparent had instead made a transfer to the child, there would have been an estate or gift tax on the grandparent's transfer to the child and another estate or gift tax on the transfer from the child to the grandchild. The GST tax attempts to basically impose an additional tax to account for this kind of missed bite at the apple that the government would have if they weren't to tax the intermediate transfer, let's say, or deemed transfer by the child to the grandchild. It applies to direct transfers, as described in my example, but it also can apply to certain indirect transfers, including transfers to certain types of trusts. In addition to the federal transfer taxes, there's also state and local transfer taxes that may apply. Each state is kind of all over the map here. Some states don't have any estate or gift tax or inheritance tax. Some do. So for example, Illinois, New York, Washington, DC, they have an estate tax. New Jersey has an inheritance tax, which we don't have at a federal level. So an inheritance tax imposes a tax on the recipient of the inheritance rather than on the assets of the deceased, on the estate of the deceased. And then Maryland is a bit of an outlier here in that it has both an estate and an inheritance tax in certain circumstances. There are very few states that have a gift tax, but Connecticut is one of those. So while federal transfer taxes are important and they'll be the primary focus of this presentation, it's also important to look at state and local transfer taxes that could apply, particularly if you're dealing with a person or assets located in one of these jurisdictions that have these taxes, because the rules can be quite different. So moving on to the next slide, just diving into greater detail on the types of tax rates and exemptions that apply for transfer taxes. So before we get into that, I just want to mention that these slides, the next two slides, really only apply to what they call U.S. domiciliaries. So that's U.S. citizens, U.S. green card holders, and persons who have a present intention to remain in the United States indefinitely. If you are a person who doesn't meet those categories, then some of these slides would not apply to you. So in general, we have tax rates of 40% for estate, gift, and GST tax. That's been the case for some time now, but historically there's been different rates for each type of transfer tax. So historically we had a different rate for the estate tax versus the gift tax versus the GST tax. For the last several years, however, we've had kind of a unified 40% tax across the board. There's an annual exclusion from the gift tax, which is indexed for inflation per year, every year. So currently that amount is $17,000 per donee for 2023. So for example, a husband and wife with three children could gift $17,000 to each child and then double that amount, so $34,000, because there's two people making those gifts. And that would not be considered a gift subject to gift tax. Importantly, in order to qualify for this annual exclusion amount, the gift must be of a present interest. So you can't say, I'm going to keep a life estate and give the child the remainder interest, for example. That's not a present interest. But they could say, I'm going to give $17,000 cash to a child right now. In addition to the annual exclusion from the gift tax, we have a lifetime exemption from the gift and estate tax. That's currently about $13 million for 2023. It's indexed for inflation every year. That exemption applies to both lifetime gifts and to estate tax. So for example, if someone gave $13 million during their lifetime, then they would have used all of their exemption and would have no exemption remaining on their passing. very importantly here, that exemption is at its highest point. The Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of 2017 basically doubled the exemption that existed in prior years. That exemption is, however, going to sunset starting on January 1, 2026. The amount will be half of the amount it currently is. And that's if Congress does nothing, although given where Congress is these days, it's very likely that Congress is probably going to do nothing, and that amount will sunset. So what we're seeing is many clients are trying to take advantage of that higher exemption now by making transfers during their lifetime to lock in that higher $13 million exemption. For married couples, you basically get a double exemption. So for someone who's married, they actually get a $26 million exemption if they were to make lifetime transfers during their lifetime. Like I said, the exemption is unified for gifts and estate tax, but there's also a separate $13 million exemption for generation skipping transfer taxes. So it's important when filing gift tax returns or when looking at the estate of somebody to realize that there may be different exemption amounts remaining based on whether they've made lifetime gifts and whether they've allocated their generation skipping transfer tax exemption to those amounts. Moving on to transfer taxes again, and some more kind of specific issues. So for married couples, there's some interesting rules that apply. As I mentioned before, for that $13 million lifetime exemption, spouses can basically double that for lifetime gifts. That's done by way of what we call gift splitting. So both spouses can consent to make gifts together, even if all the money comes from one spouse. And that can be done for the lifetime exemption for $13 million. It can also be done for the annual exclusion amount, the $17,000. There's portability between spouses for unused exemptions if one spouse dies. So for example, if one spouse had made no lifetime transfers and dies with a $7 million estate, that would leave them with $6 million of their $13 million that's unused. Their recipient spouse, the surviving spouse, could use that $6 million when he or she passes away. It's basically called porting over their unused exemption. So that's a very powerful tool for spouses, especially when you have spouses with slightly different assets and net worths. And then there's an unlimited marital deduction for gifts and inheritances between or received by U.S. citizen spouses. So one spouse can pass away and leave $100 million to a U.S. citizen spouse, or make a lifetime gift of $100 million to a U.S. citizen spouse. And that would not attract the gift tax or estate tax of 40%, even though that transfer was well above the $13 million lifetime exemption. Importantly, tax basis is an issue that we see kind of in the focus, if you will, of various legislative proposals on the estate and gift tax. So one's tax basis is basically one's cost, right? So when you sell an asset, let's say you purchased it for $100 and you sell it for $200, right? Your tax basis is 100 and your gain is 100, right? The difference between 200 and 100. For purposes of the estate and gift tax, assets included in the estate of somebody receive an automatic step up in basis, so that when the recipient sells it, instead of, in my example, of paying tax on the different on a basis of 100, they'll pay tax on a basis of 200, which can be a very powerful tool if you have assets that are highly appreciated over time. Think about, you know, a home someone bought in the 1980s and compared with home values today. If that home is inherited and then sold by one's heirs, that's a very powerful tax planning tool and often utilized by our clients. As you can imagine, some folks in Congress don't like that. That's been an angle of attack that we've seen in certain legislative proposals. They haven't really made it through, but that's something that, you know, that we should keep in mind here, because it's something that currently is the law and has been the law for some time. Unlike the basis step up on death, for gifts, however, one gets a carryover basis. So rather, if you make a gift of something that's worth 200 and your basis is 100, the recipient would carry over, step into the shoes of the donor, and keep a basis of 100. So sometimes it actually makes more sense for folks to inherit assets and have them get the basis step up on death, rather than to make a gift during lifetime and get that carryover basis, especially for highly appreciated assets. In addition to these issues that we discussed on marital tax planning and tax basis, there's also a charitable deduction from the estate and gift tax. Now, these rules are slightly different from the income tax charitable deduction that Tori is going to get into in greater detail. But basically, it's an unlimited charitable deduction against estate and gift tax. So that can be a very powerful tool as well, especially for high net worth individuals, because the assets of one's estate are basically reduced by the amount of any charitable gifts. So with that, I'm going to pass things on to Tori to get more into the charitable planning techniques that we see.
Yeah. And Tori, maybe I'll just take a quick moment before passing things over to you to really bring back as to how these exemptions would reflect in those estate planning documents that we were talking about at the beginning in your will and revocable trust. You know, these exemptions, it's very frustrating because, as we were talking about, they fluctuate, right? And so rather than those intestate laws that might just set you at 50% to a spouse and 50% to your children, these formulas essentially give you the opportunity to say, I would like to give to my children, you know, the maximum amount of my exemption that can pass tax-free, and then have, you know, whatever the balance of my estate is, for example, go to my spouse that will then be tax-free, because as a U.S. citizen spouse, there will be no taxation, or perhaps the balance will pass to charity so that there will be no taxation. So there's really an opportunity there to customize, you know, building off of what these tax exemptions are, to both have the opportunity to be very thoughtful in your tax planning if you have an estate that will get triggered by some of these taxes. And Tori, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but to turn it over to talk about really on the charitable side, how do we see these structures really apply within some of the different opportunities?
Okay, thanks so much, Elizabeth. So I'm going to talk a little bit about charitable planning. And, you know, according to Giving USA's most recent report, Americans gave about $485 billion to charity in 2021. And, you know, two-thirds of that, or 67% of that total, was attributable to gifts made by individuals. And about 9% of that $485 billion was attributable to charitable bequests. So bequests under someone's estate plan, gifts made at death. You know, why do people give to charity? I think many people are driven by this desire to help others and support causes and organizations that are important to them, including, for example, supporting their alma mater or their church. And the federal tax code incentivizes contributions to charity by providing deductions against income tax and also, as Arianne mentioned, estate tax. So while some people are very driven by the tax deduction, even for those who aren't, maximizing tax savings is just an added benefit that you get when you're giving to charity. And there are certain charitable giving strategies that combine both giving to charity and giving to family, which is attractive to many donors. So listed here on this slide are some important things to consider when thinking about whether to make a charitable gift, and if so, what asset to contribute and how to structure that contribution. So first, what are your charitable goals? What causes are the most important to you? And what kind of impact do you want your gift to have? Are you more interested in long-term or short-term impact? And like I mentioned before, do you want your gift to also benefit perhaps your family? The size of the contribution is another important thing to think about. So whether it's a one-off, or is it going to be part of a series of gifts that you plan to make to that same charitable organization? The answer to that question can kind of lead you to choose certain strategies over others. And we'll talk in a little bit about the different types of strategies and what, you know, if you're going to make a bunch of gifts to the same organization, why you might choose certain strategies instead of others. What kind of assets do you want to give away? And is that the right type of asset for this particular charity that you want to benefit? So cash is easy, and many charities, especially smaller charities, might prefer gifts of cash. But many charities also welcome gifts of non-cash assets. So for example, appreciated marketable securities, real estate, or closely held business interests. Retirement assets. For many people, their retirement assets represent the bulk of their accumulated wealth. And so it's an obvious place to look when you're looking at what are my available assets that I can use to give to charity. And as I'll talk about in a little bit, retirement assets, there are some additional kind of income tax kind of benefits that you get when you use retirement assets for your charitable planning. Is this an asset that you are willing to part with during life? Or would you rather keep the asset for your life, but then you would, giving it to charity at death is something that appeals to you versus giving it that asset to your heirs? Timing. What is primarily motivating you when you're deciding, is this something I want to give during life or at death? Do you want to reduce estate tax, or is it reducing income tax, or something else? How much control do you want to have over this contributed asset? Do you want the gift that you're making to charity to be restricted for certain purposes, or can the charity use it for their general charitable purposes wherever they see a need? And then what is your tolerance for complexity and ongoing administration? So there's a range of charitable giving techniques from, like I said, very simple, straight gifts of cash to more complex techniques such as charitable split interest trusts, which are not really kind of give it and forget it type techniques. So your tolerance for complexity and ongoing administration is going to be important when you're choosing how and what to give. Can we get the next slide? So here's just some general rules. As Arianne said, I'm kind of focusing more on the federal income tax deduction. And generally for federal income tax purposes, only gifts to US charities are deductible. And so some examples of charitable organizations where contributions to which are deductible would be religious organizations, hospitals, schools, and universities, publicly supported organizations like the Red Cross, private foundations, governmental entities, and donor-advised funds. And just a quick note about donor-advised funds, because it's something that a lot of people have kind of heard of vaguely, but might not completely understand what that is. A donor-advised fund is a charitable giving vehicle which is administered by a public charity that manages charitable donations on behalf of organizations and individuals. So you as the donor, when you make your contribution or donation to a donor advised fund, you relinquish legal control of the asset, but you can make, as the advisor to that fund, you can make non-binding recommendations to the donor advised fund administrator for the use of the funds. So you can say to them, I recommend that you distribute, $1,000 to, X charitable organization. And so there are many advantages to using donor advised funds, but they generally don't work as well if what you want to do, what your charitable goals are, are to like fund specific scholarships or do matching gifts or restricted gifts. But they do work really well for international giving. So one thing to think about when you're thinking about what type of charity you're going to donate to. Contributed property can only be used for charitable purposes. So for example, you can't give property to a charity and say, you have to use this money that I'm giving you to pay a specific person's salary, or to fund a scholarship for a specific student. However, a donor can impose restrictions on the use of those assets as long as that use is charitable. So you might give funds to a university and say you have to use this to build a new academic building or to endow a professorship or things like that. Property can't revert back to the donor. You won't get a charitable deduction if you say, you can use this, I'm giving you $1,000, except that you have to give it back to me if X, Y, and Z. So something to consider if you're looking at the deduction as one of your motivators. And the donor is generally not permitted to receive any benefit or any quid pro quo from the charity as a result of his or her contribution to that charity without reducing the amount of the charitable deduction. So there are some exceptions to this. So recognition, like naming rights, that's an exception. De minimis benefits, like a like maybe a mug that you get in return for your contribution to a charity, and other intangible benefits, like I guess an example of that would be if I make a donation to this charitable organization, the religious organization, the nuns will pray for me, something like that. And then just a couple other really general rules. So a contribution to charity of an interest in property that's less than your entire interest in that property is generally disallowed. So for example, if you wanted to contribute the rent-free use of office space, that would not be deductible. Or if you wanted to assign your dividends to charity, that's not deductible, but you could receive the cash dividend yourself and then give it to charity because you've now just given the dividend instead of kind of, you know, severing your, trying to sever your interest in the security. There are some exceptions to this rule. So like a remainder interest in a residence, that is deductible if given to charity. Conservation easement is another exception to that. Can I get the next slide? Okay, so as I mentioned before, certain contributions to charity can be deducted from your gross income, subject to some important limitations. So generally the amount that you can deduct for federal income tax purposes depends on several factors. One, whether the property contributed is cash or other property like stock, real estate, or tangible personal property. If the property isn't cash, is it capital gain property, meaning an asset that you've held for more than a year? What is the type of charity that you're donating to? Is it a public charity or is it a private foundation? Different rules apply. And what is the taxpayer's adjusted gross income? Because as you'll see on the next slide, there are some limitations on the amount of deduction based on your AGI. So depending on the answers to these questions, you might be able to deduct the full fair market value of property that's contributed, or you might be limited to deducting your basis in that property. And then, you know, contributed services are not deductible. It has to be actual property. So this is just a really simple chart that shows the rules for donations to public charities. And you'll see there's all sorts of caveats on this because there are all sorts of exceptions to these rules. But generally, contributions of cash are always deductible at face value and subject to a 60% AGI limitation. A contribution of short-term gain property to a public charity is deductible up to the lesser of fair market value and basis, although there are some exceptions for things like inventory and IP. And your AGI limitation for a donation of that property is 50%. And contributions of long-term capital gain property are generally deductible at fair market value, but subject to an AGI limitation of 30%. And there are a couple of you know, exceptions to that rule, like for tangible personal property, that tangible property that the charity is not going to use for its exempt purposes. It's just, it's not fair market value. You have to value it at basis. And there's also some other elections that you might make to elect to use a 50% AGI limitation for donations of long-term capital gain property. But if you do that, then you have to value your property at cost, at basis. Next slide. And so this this slide just kind of lists some of the charitable giving strategies that one might employ when looking to give give to charity. So these run the gamut from really simple to really complex. So when you're considering what strategy might be right for you, you have to kind of look at your overall estate plan, your ability or willingness to part with an asset completely versus maintaining some sort of income stream from it, and your need for and ability to actually use a federal income tax deduction. So cash gifts are simple and effective. Appreciated stock is a popular asset to contribute to charity because it avoids a capital gain tax. So if you sold the stock, appreciated stock, you would incur a capital gains tax. If you give the stock to charity and then the charity sells it, no tax is incurred by the charity because the charity is a tax exempt organization. You get the full fair market value charitable deduction subject to the AGI limitation. Retirement assets. Like I said before, they're a really popular category of assets to contribute to charity because for many people, they represent the bulk of their accumulated wealth. And distributions from non-Roth retirement plans are generally taxable as ordinary income. And those distributions are mandatory once the account holder reaches age 73. There might be a lot of reasons why an account holder might not want to take one of those required minimum distributions. They might have plenty of other assets to live on and not really need it. Taking that required minimum distribution could push them into a higher tax bracket, which could affect their qualification for other deductions and for Social Security benefits, things like that. So during life, a person, you might want to cash out your 401k or your IRA. You could pay the income tax associated with that distribution to you, and then you could give the proceeds to charity. Or, you might receive your required minimum distribution and then donate it to charity, but there's not really a tax benefit to doing that way. Instead, if you were to donate to charity directly from your IRA, then that required minimum distribution amount is never distributed to you, so it's not included in your gross income. And you might get even more of a tax savings from that than you would with a kind of straight up cash gift, because that minimum distribution didn't come out to you, it's not included in your income. So your AGI is lower than if you had taken the distribution yourself. And like I said before, that AGI is used to determine like what credits and deductions you might qualify for. So individuals who've reached age 70 and a half can do what's called a charitable IRA rollover, which would allow you to instruct the IRA administrator to transfer up to $100,000 per year to one or more operating charities. And you can also direct a one-time $50,000 qualified charitable distribution to a charitable remainder trust, which we'll talk a little bit more about in a minute, or to a charitable gift annuity. That rule, that $100,000 a year starting next year in 2024 is indexed for inflation. But this rule applies only to IRAs. So you can't do this from a 401k plan, but you could roll your 401k over into like a traditional IRA and then do these charitable distributions from the IRA. You could also name charity as a beneficiary of your retirement assets at your death. The benefits of doing that include the estate qualification for the estate tax charitable deduction. So you're offsetting the amount of estate tax that might be otherwise due. And there's no income tax then on distribution of those retirement assets to your heirs that would otherwise apply, just like the rules we talked about for required minimum distributions to the account holder. Another thing listed here is the charitable gift annuity. So a charitable gift annuity is a contract between charity and a donor that provides a lifetime annuity stream to the donor with the remainder going to charity. And if the actuarial value of the annuity stream based on your life expectancy at the time that you make the gift, if that actuarial value is less than the value of the property transferred, that difference in value will result in a charitable deduction, which you can take on your income tax return. So with a charitable gift annuity, the donor would give the asset to charity, get that tax deduction. And the charity then is like investing the assets and providing a set income stream, a set annuity to the donor for the rest of the donor's life. When the donor dies, the charity is keeping what's left. This is often offered by large charitable organizations, including Georgetown. And the American Council on Gift Annuities, which is an independent nonprofit, establishes that charitable gift annuity rate for use by charities nationwide. And like I said before, life expectancy is a factor. So the older the donor, the higher the annuity rate, because they're not expected to live as long as a younger donor. So the benefits of using a charitable gift annuity would be you're getting a regular income stream, but you're getting this upfront income tax deduction that's based on the anticipated annuity amount that will come back to you. So really quick, I'll just touch on like charitable split interest trusts. Those are charitable remainder trusts and charitable lead trusts, and they are powerful tools for individuals who want to benefit charity while also benefiting non-charitable beneficiaries like family in a tax-efficient manner. They both types of split interest trusts create an income or annuity interest and a remainder interest. For a charitable lead trust, that annuity interest or lead interest is going to charity, and whatever is left over at the end of the term is going to family. With a charitable remainder trust, it's just the opposite. So the donor or heirs or family member receive that annuity stream, that income stream during the term or the lifetime of the donor. And then at the end of that term, charity would receive the remainder. Both of those can be established during life or at death. And donor gets an immediate charitable deduction for charitable remainder trusts, and sometimes for charitable lead trusts, you get an upfront charitable deduction. And these can get kind of fancy. You can do with a charitable remainder trust, you can kind of do, there's different varieties of them where maybe for a certain period of time only income is paid out to the donor. And then at some point it flips and it becomes a set annuity amount that's paid out. So I think the thing to know really about these split interest trusts is that they're a really powerful tool. They can kind of be customized to some extent within the rules, and it might be, they can be really attractive in the right situation. So that's really everything that I had. I know we wanted to leave time for questions, so I will turn it back over.
Great, thank you so much, all. We do have a few questions. We'll do our best to get to them. The first is, yes, the question about the slides, they will be sent out with the survey at the end. And so we will send these slides with the survey. We do have a few questions. First, regarding the financial powers of attorney. I think this would be a good question for Elizabeth. We have two of them. If we have a financial power of attorney, should we also make that person a signatory on financial accounts? That's the first one.
Sure. So because you have that person listed in the financial power of attorney, you actually don't need them to also be a signatory. The idea is that at some point, you know, particularly if it's a power of attorney that becomes effective when you're incapacitated, or even if it's effective today, while you have capacity, the idea is that they can go and present that and have access to that account by virtue of being your agent. Also including them as a signatory on the account would be sort of duplicative. So it's not problematic, but in general, just to keep things clean, we would recommend, you know, you retain access over your own accounts yourself, and that this power be used, you know, especially if you've perhaps put limitations on it to only be if you're incapacitated, for example, that you would delay and wait for them. I will say that we do recommend that you have a power of attorney looked at by particularly bank authorities, because sometimes the worst case scenario that you would be in is that you've listed them appropriately as an agent, but somehow the bank, you know, finds fault with your document. So you want to make sure the bank has pre-screened your document.
Great. And staying there, Elizabeth, can two people be the financial power of attorney, and is there an age limit to serve as power of attorney?
Sure. So this varies a little bit state by state. In most places, So you do have to a minimum be an adult. So you have to be over the age of 18. I don't believe there are any states that have it older than 18, but you would want to check locally just in case maybe one or two places would have age 21. And then also whether or not it can be one or two people can be a state-based rule. But in those states that would allow more than one person to act at a time, you are generally given a couple of different options. So one option would be that you have, let's say, two people, either one of whom can act autonomously, so meaning you have two agents. The risk in a circumstance like that, of course, is that they're doing different things at the same time that may be contradictory. You also then could have a circumstance, and you can either write this in your document or it may be mandated by state law, that if you have more than one person, they have to act either unanimously, perhaps if there's three or four people, they have to act by majority. And just the one practical caveat is that when you have multiple individuals, you know, just consider how effective will they be able to act on your behalf. If it's two people who, you know, interact a lot and are very coordinated, just logistically, that may be fine. If you've picked two people who don't particularly know each other or may have difficulties coordinating, it may practically impact their ability to work for you.
Great, thanks. I realize I didn't have my camera on. Let's go to Tori. There's a question here about revocable trusts. I hear some people set up a revocable trust but forget to fund it. Can you please explain the specific steps to avoid this type of pitfall?
So generally what we would recommend doing is signing documents to assign property to your revocable trust during lifetime. Barring that, you can always provide in your will that anything that is not titled in your revocable trust at the time of your death will kind of pass to your revocable trust, so that your revocable trust then kind of works as the estate planning tool that Elizabeth had mentioned. It's kind of it does all of the work, even if you don't have everything titled there at death. It works as long as your will says everything goes there.
Okay.
Keep in mind that when you die, for example, accounts held in joint tenancy between spouses, for example, with right of survivorship, that's going to bypass all of this work that you've done. So to Tori's point, assigning property to a trust during your lifetime means simply you might set up an account, a brokerage account in the name of your revocable trust, and your part of the joint assets would go into your trust and your partner's would go into his or her trust. So it's a very important point, because you don't want to go through all the work of setting up your estate plan and then just have it bypassed because everything's account titled in joint name.
Yep, great point, Neil. Okay, we'll do one question with a 1 minute answer. I'll stick with Tori, but anyone can answer it because it's a very tactical question and very relevant. Physically, where should our estate planning documents be stored? I've heard that if you have it in a safety deposit at a bank, that can create access problems for your family. Does it have to be at a lawyer's office or be something given to your family members that have signed that has legal force of law?
So there are access problems with a safety deposit box. If you're going to keep it there, you want to make sure that some family member has access to that box and can get into it at your death. But we just normally recommend you keep it in a safe place and make sure people know where that is. So maybe a home fireproof safe, if you have one, with your important papers. And like I said, the important thing to know to do is to make sure that your partner or your children or other family members know where to go to get it.
Right. Well, that takes us right to 1 o'clock Eastern. So first of all, thank you so much to Tori and Elizabeth and Arianne and Neil, just a fantastic job. Thank you to all of us who joined us. As we said, we'll be sending out a survey. We really encourage you to take it. It'll just take 2 or 3 minutes to complete. We want to ensure that these webinars continue to be valuable for you. We'll include the slides with the survey as well. If you have additional questions, please feel free to reach out to us here at the Office of Plan Giving. My name is Jason Baxendale. My colleague is Mindy Siebenaller. My email is jb3099@georgetown.edu, or you can feel free to call us directly at 202-687-1747. We're happy to answer any questions. And again, thanks to our panel, and thank you to all for joining us. Have a terrific day. Take care.
Thank you.